like bathtub ceiling. The way it's,
Are you taking photos of all these things?
Yeah, I'm taking a few. Slowly, got lots of tape. Some serious stuff.
Thank you.
I'll just do it. That is amazing. I mean, you just never ever would expect to see that. I mean, that's the thing about this stuff. You can see every possible. Okay.
And slowly, because if you ever run across something you want to look at again, you'll want to be able to freeze frame that thing.
It looks as though this area has failed completely in compression because the element is straight until we come to an area just above the spandrel connection where all sides of the box section have just splayed outwards. It looks like it might have been hit by something as well because there's a piece torn out there.
Sixth floor, maybe. Let's see here. 19 tons. Got a piece number. 8309-2326. As far as connections go, this 56th floor section did exactly what one would hope. Connections were stronger than the material being joined. And some of those holes never had bolts in them. There's no holes in the plates, so the bolts remained that were there. But no evidence of bolts just simply popping. And this whole three-story section is the same in each of the connections. Sheared material, connections, and fine. This being the strangest element of it, nuts that have been practically guillotined off without taking the bolt with them. This one taking cleanly right up against the edge of the bolt, yet not even happening so fast it didn't even distort the bolt and bend it. Just sheared the nut. Second one in got torsionally bent some. Let's see the original imprint. Thank you. In many cases, the bolts, the tension bolts, can still be found in the boxes. In some cases, they can. Tough to see. That all was part of the same column. Looks like someone put a firecracker in the end of it. Have I done zoom on this or something? Because it seems to be a lot closer, and it's right here. This button.
Oh.
What was that second?
That's when you put it onto record. Yeah.
Thank you. clean. Doesn't look very intense.
Spray paint.
I think we left it over by where we first came in.
Okay. I might go and grab it then and just paint these pieces.
4 inches. Classic brittle. Some dark dust up in there. This particular piece of the column found exactly what one would hope was every one of the fasteners was still in the box, so they could be readily removed and perhaps something learned from the way they failed. That's the collection sitting there on that plate, all of which came out of this one connection. An access hole for this connection right here, column to column.
Should I mark that?
Sure, go ahead. Oh, sorry. Opened up like a sardine thing. And all the tack welds. By and large, almost completely. This is about the only one we've seen. Certainly the biggest one we've seen. Still managing to be attached. And I found fasteners inside this box section, which I'm taking. And as well as a few from this side. Now this side was full of a lot of this delaminated looking fragments. Quite full of them, in fact. There's a stack there, but smaller ones here. This was a lot of it as well, broken up into smaller pieces. And I don't know if it shows in the video, but this whole piece is one slow bow to that end. And I got a fastener out of that end as well. Both ends looking, having been exposed to fire, well, this end more dramatically so. You can see how concave that piece is. Somewhat concave, but not as much as this side is. There's actually portions of metal drippings on the inside. I'm going to try to grab one if I can get it. Other pieces we've set aside. This one is a possible candidate for the impact area. Anna Maria has a decoding book that she brought with her for helping us decode the markings and establish the floors. Prior to that, we've been basing most of our assumptions on the size of the piece, size of the plate it's made up of, how many fasteners are holding the columns together. Hard to find a fabricator that would want to put that bend in it for you. And this is another piece that we suspect saw a lot of heat from the fire. Pretty much the last of the pile on this end of the yard. And actually it turns out lucky we showed up today, because the very next piece to be processed that we hadn't seen before is from a rather high up floor. Has all the markings to help us identify it, which is pretty rare. And has some unique plastic deformation suggesting that it may be from the impact area, the way it goes from the outer portion of the column to the inner portion. That region looking something like what a bullet might look to do going through a small piece of metal. Of course, that's not a small piece of metal. So we'll set it aside and see what else we're going to learn from it. is the Keysby yard. It's very organized. Everything's been brought in and more or less sorted by similar types, sizes. That's the area where we were earlier today. More of the perimeter columns and things are over there, and the core columns are over here. Somewhat fascinating from a connections point of view. It's comparatively high up. No elongation of the bolt holes, which has been common. Yet here on the spandrel plates,
18 parking space.
Can't get a machine that clean in the laboratory. Can I borrow your metal rule for a sec?
Sure.
Bit of a transition of how the weld responded from unfortunately some of the biggest heaviest pieces are now on top of the smaller ones, inhibiting our ability to get some of the pieces from higher up. Get at some of the pieces from higher up. A different category of scrap at Schnitzer East Yard. Some of which is obviously the aluminum skin, some of which is, for example, trusses, floor truss pieces. Also, light pieces from high up that get mixed in because presumably they were smaller pieces, but we definitely have quite a number of smaller, lighter perimeter columns and things from presumably up pretty high. This pile is, I don't know, 30 feet high or something like that. And it's not particularly safe for climbing in. Done with these couple of pieces.
Pardon me?
What are we done with these?
the way it's like to sort of tie up three pieces for you guys.
These two we're going to give them back to you as soon as we're done documenting.
These two here?
These two here, yeah.
They'll be able to clean this up. Go through whatever you have save written on that is not one of your three pieces.
Okay.
Put a big number one, two, or three on the three you want. Anything else, just cross through the save so that way I know I'm sorting out the last thing I steal now. Okay, and that way I'll be able to.
Thank you.
That was K16 and we're going to do K17 now.
Okay. We're allowed to keep three, they're saying now.
What?
We just got permission last night to keep three permanently, it sounds like. So we'll keep the ones from the 90s. I'll tape it.
The thickness of the web varies from 1¾ inches on this side down to 1⅜ inches on the other side. What? He's gonna have to hold it
on the other side. The other.
Try to establish the top. Try to look at it there.
That spandrel. I mean, less. It's way less than a quarter now. It's like an eighth or something.
Nothing.
It's like 10. All right. So this, the steel. Maybe that's the answer to this whole puzzle. The fire did away with
it. Yeah, looks like a thing.
Perhaps that explains the variation in thickness we're seeing overall. Although it's amazingly even, isn't it? It's almost like peeled off layers.
Good.
One time four being the left side being shallow. Simply that piece that shows different failure modes of connections. Bolt shearing up the spandrel plate. A bolt, or in this case two bolts, breaking out of this 3/8 inch thick seat without even scraping the primer, let alone elongating the holes. The holes were oval to begin with. The primer still is all around them. And then this connection held fast. I've since learned that there are not pins more fastened than those little tiny holes of viscous system, which explains the material, dried-like material found on those. Evidently, the cutting crews will be through everything today. And we've been given permission to number three pieces for saving. Number one is K13 on the other side. Number two is this piece right here. And number three, we're still trying to choose. We can only hope that this will be kept and not processed. Okay, the marking is upside down, but it's 559. It's an interesting connection. Just let's see if we can get an overview from up here. There we go. It's a column going down through there. Additional markings 4-5100 something. It's like there's. It looked like there's a normal connection there. I'm not sure what that was.
So now you have more markings. One got chopped off there. Of a perimeter column has half-inch spandrel plates, suggesting it's not from the bottom of the building, and it's the first one we've seen that has concrete inside.
the flanges on the cross section are thick. It's an inch.
C14.
This is a very interesting piece here. It's thin enough, the spandrel and everything, but it's got almost every
Every connection is what?
It's three columns.
Every connection looks like what?
Well, there's remnants.
Oh.
Like every connection.
Alrighty, I'll be over in a minute. So C14 has one of its interesting features is this. Looks like a bullet went through there. I don't know if that's from being struck while it was standing or falling. Something with a lot of velocity went through there and flared that open. Has some bits that suggest fire, such as this. It's also attached to one of these corner boxes. It's late. Quarter inch plates, 3/8. So C15 is a partial ace. This I'm taping because this is the first time we've seen this in all of us. It's the first time I've seen it. I don't know if any other members have seen it. I haven't seen it in any yard yet. But 3 out of 4 of the bolts are still in that one. And this is attached by a spandrel to another piece. The same story there. 3 out of 4 are still intact. I'd love to get a nutcracker and take those nuts off and check out these bolts. And likewise, the third piece in this setup has 3 out of 4. So, very interesting. First time. And although this is a slightly higher up piece, it's heavier in construction. So, suggesting it's from the lower floor, that plate looks to be about 5/8 inch thick, something like that. Look for some markings to help to identify this thing. But it's not a very light piece, which makes it all the more interesting that the bolts were able to withstand it. This is C16.
Yep.
Which is
section C18. 3 columns, 2 spandrels. a W section, possibly from World Trade Center 7. It was flattened where the top flange meets the bottom flange. And you can see the cutouts for the utilities as they disrupt the buckled web along its entire length.
Thank you.
25. Slightly more substantial piece with this angle, no evidence of fire damage. However, according to our decoder, it is from the 89th or higher floor, so worthy of keeping just to the fact that it's intact. In case anyone should have a question later on whether or not it would have been. C13, that was our first piece from yesterday, or 2 days ago.
Piece is flattened so that the flange meets the flange. And there are utility cutouts in the web. Side of the flattened piece with the utility cutouts.
Hi there, how you doing, Gary? Alrighty, I'll give you some, get ready to write it down. I can give you some directions for you. They don't because there's a detour. Yeah, it's the same problem. But you go out the Holland Tunnel, you get on the turnpike, and you get right off 114B. Just after you pass the pole, the directions would have had you go to the left. You have to go to the right instead. You go over a big overpass, and you come down to a traffic light in a little town. And you want to be in the left lane there. And you turn left, you go through this little town. That goes along for about a quarter of a mile. And you come to a T intersection. And you want to turn left at the T intersection. Be careful there because the traffic comes fast from the right. It's kind of a line. So you go left there and it's straight.
This piece is not from high up, but it is a good example of how well marked things can occasionally be. So it's actually very readable. Not only are the stamping marks easy to see, we've got duplication in some of the information, but additional information as well. So amazingly, easy to tell that that piece is not one what we're looking for. You see some residue around the hole, almost like a glue from a duct tape type effect, where they presumably had something covering these at some point.
Mitten weld on a tension zone.
Well, it has to do with the shear that's going through. Just like when you design a plate girder and you're designing the connection of the web to the plate, there's a a shear stress.
Yeah.
You calculate the shear stress and you determine the number of...
So they're not worried about fatigue or anything like that?
No, no. And if anything, the shear is highest in the center of the web area and slowest when you get down into the flange. And so they didn't need a continuous step all the time.
Alright.
And it's a lot cheaper than
because on bridges, you are worried about the tension.
Yeah.
So you're not allowed to hit the bridge
anywhere
in the tension zone.
You do it all the time.
Okay. So there's your... Alright.
So the weak part of this is what you would anticipate though, right?
Excuse me?
The weak link of this
procedure is what you'd anticipate. It's going to be the welds are going to break free.
Yeah, and then it's just acting as two separate pieces. Like right over here, it just popped right apart. And up over here, you can see like it started to belly up, then it comes back down at the weld, and it bellies up again.
It's interesting, but I don't know if it's something that's worth saving.
Okay.
Yeah. It's just because it's not encountered in a building unless it's catastrophic.
So you do this rather than go for a bigger, a heavier member to begin with?
Well, or many if times there's a height restraint, a constraint. Maybe they, because of the ceiling restriction, they can't put a bigger beam in there. They'll put a smaller beam in. They do that with columns too, usually the 14-inch column is the biggest you're going to go with, but you need bigger, so they just put plates on them.
Or if you're adding later on?
What? That's the other reason, if you need to strengthen the. Although if you're going to strengthen.
There's C20.
Interesting for World Trade Center 7.
3/4 inch web. I'm sorry, 3/4 inch flange thickness.
That'd be
CTF, right?
TF, yeah. We have top and bottom. So
it would be the same, yeah. Flange width is 10 1/4.
Beg your pardon?
The flange width is 10 1/4.
Anyone that's crazy about climbing, you'd have to be crazy to climb this.
Yeah. There's a lot of clothing in
there. What do you think that is? Is that about 30, 40 feet tall up there?
Yeah.
It actually has portions that are concave. I don't see us climbing anywhere around that. Lots of truss stuff in there, like that one right there. Aluminum cladding.
So this is where our C-22 ended up. I don't think anybody's going to be trying to pull it out at the moment. I guess this is what they're just taking off the barge now, huh?
Yep.
Yeah, right, there's another C-shaped one in there. Still seems awful ironic to be standing here looking at the steel with the backdrop being the Statue of Liberty.
There's a tree piece over there with a stencil very clear on it. Gonna walk over there and see if I can read what
the
floors are.
The three together there?
Yeah.
I might be able to read it with the zoom here. If I could hold it steady. It's like 7 tons. I can't quite see where the floor markings are. The last thing I can see is the 7T. But we can probably look at the bottom and see the stampings. It's all gone. It's chopped off.